O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace be yours this day from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The text comes to us today from our epistle lesson in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the 18th verse. The word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. To us who are being saved, it's the power of God. You ever think about that? When you come to church and read from God's word, that it's the power of God for us who are being saved. It's power. You hear the words that we are forgiven in Jesus. It's the power of God to know that Christ died for us. It's the power of God to know that he has taken us who are sinners, enemies of God, and have turned us into children of the Heavenly Father. It's power. Not only did Jesus die, not only was Jesus raised from the grave, but the power is this. He died and rose for you and for me. So do me a favor. Turn to the person next to you and say, Jesus forgives you. Good. Say it like you mean it. So there's more than one person beside you. Go ahead. Jesus forgives you. Right. Really important there, isn't it? That's the power of God. It's the joy that we have. The power of God. And not knowing what's going to happen day to day, but we have peace because the power of God says that we are his children. It's the hope that we have. Even though that we will one day be in the ground or we will be put in an urn in our ashes, we know that we will be raised. Nothing can take away that hope. Nothing can take away that joy. It is the power of God for you and for me that Jesus Christ died and rose again. And it's the central theme of the church's teaching. For what we believe, what we confess, that's why we do it every time. We say the Nicene Creed, the Apostles' Creed. That's what we hear from the pulpit. That's what we pray in our prayers. That's what we taste as we come to the communion table. It's the Word of God in flesh for us. But at the same time, it's not a word that you hear everywhere you go. So we hear different things as we leave this place. As we go out on the streets, we're led to believe different things that we should believe in, different things that we should trust, different things that we should place our hope in, which is why it's so important that when you lay your heads down at night, you say to your spouse, Jesus forgives you. Or when you're talking to your children about their day, they talk about the hurts that they have, or maybe the hardships that they're going through, that you remind them every day, Jesus forgives you. Loves you. And when the church members come to you and they say, can you have a prayer with me, please? I'm hurting, or my sister is hurting, my mother is suffering. We don't just say, I'll pray for you, but we say, yes, let's pray now. And oh, by the way, Jesus loves you. It's the power of God that we need in a world that is so hurting. That's why Paul writes this. I'm convinced of that. The church needs to remember what they are focused on because there are too many outside things, outside elements, outside forces, outside wisdom that's trying to influence it in a different direction. See, that's really the big problem with really all the churches that Paul is talking to, but especially the church in Corinth. They are really having a hard time staying focused on what really is the Word of God and the wisdom of God. And you can't really blame them in one sense. The Church of Corinth was established in a city that really was fairly new. The Romans occupied it around 44 BC. So it really is a growing community, but it's a community that's really in the center of a lot of diversity. People are coming from all over the place to go through this little city and use its ports and such. And so as a result, you find all kinds of temples, all kinds of worshiping spots, all kinds of beliefs, but all kinds of thinking. Because that's the focus for Greeks and for Romans, is to think. If you can think it, you can believe it. If you can think it and persuade others to believe it, then it must true. You see, that's how truth was developed. You can have a good debate. You can have a good conversation and sway the audience, and someone else cannot match your wit, then that must be the truth that everybody should follow. So it wasn't a matter of tradition or the Word of God that was established, but who could speak the best? Who could make the best argument? Who could make the best speech and thus be proved? We have this kind of thinking that's coming into the church. But you also have some other issues as well. You have the Jews and you have the Gentiles all bringing with them their thoughts. You have the Jews who are telling the Gentiles, you have to follow the laws as we do in order to be saved. And then you have the Gentiles who are saying, no, we were saved by the law, which is true, but that means we can now do whatever we want. You see, both of those situations are not focused on the cross. Both of those situations are focused on themselves. And the issue is, when you bring all of that together, it's not going to mix. In fact, Martin Luther says this to the Church of Corinth. The mad saints came along, as well as the immature know-it-alls. They broke up the unity of the doctrine and caused division among believers. So no one was really sure what to do, who to follow. Look, you have Paul over here, maybe we should follow him. You have Apollos over here, maybe we should follow him. Well, you have these Gentiles over here who are saying we should follow their gods along with Jesus. And when it's all said and done, you're just very confused individuals and don't know what they're supposed to believe. So I guess maybe the question here is for us. What is the Word of God to this world today? Guess what? It's still a stumbling block to Jews and folly to the Gentiles. But for us who are being saved, it's the power of God. But it's hard, isn't it? Because we too can be influenced by it. A great word comes along and it might seem new, but it's really the old way of thinking. Do you really believe that the Word of God is true? Come on. Do you really believe what you're saying and confessing? Do you really believe that God took on flesh? Though, that this man's heart stopped beating and that all of a sudden he came to life. Do you really believe that all those miracles happened, that people were blind but could see? Do you really believe all of those magic tricks? Do you really believe that morality is something that's important nowadays in our life era where we know so much? Do you really believe that God is the one that created the heavens and the earth? You guys are foolish. This sermon is entitled, God Called a Fool When He Called Me. The truth is, sometimes it does weigh on us, doesn't it? Well, maybe we hear those words that we start to wonder. Or we like the Gentiles? Maybe it doesn't matter how we live. Maybe morality isn't really an issue. We can do whatever we want. Or, like the Jews, I'm here on Sunday morning. I gave my offerings. I did everything that I'm supposed to do. I served my time in this congregation. I am all good. It's stumbling block. And it's folly. But for those who are called, and we are called, it's the power of God. Isn't that why we come? Not because we have it right. Not because we know we are good. But because we know the Holy Spirit needs to work in us to make us good. We know God's word is what changes us. That's why we're here. Which is why this will remain the central teaching of the church. Which is why we're not going to change. Which is why we're going to continue to proclaim Jesus Christ and his death and his resurrection is the central teaching for us. Because nothing else in this world can bring us peace. Nothing else in this world can give us hope for the future but Jesus Christ and his death and his resurrection. Nothing else can give us joy in this life about what is to come. Even when we are in our last days and we see the end is going to come. No philosophy, no thoughts, no things that people can say, no politician, no thing of the world can give us the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. So do I believe the Word of God is true? Absolutely. Do I believe that this man died and rose again? I believe that this man who is man and God, God and divine, rose from the grave. I believe that he ascended on high, and I believe, we believe, that he sent his Holy Spirit among us, that he would bring all of us together, that somehow he could make something beautiful out of this mess that is in our midst. I believe that God has come to redeem us, poor, sinful individuals, and that we will one day dwell with him. I believe this to be the truth, and the world might call us foolish, but I believe it is the power of God. And together, I pray that we live out that power. Not worried about what people say. Not worried of the arguments, the empty and vain deceitfulness. But we continue in the power of God, proclaiming his truth, so that other fools may come to believe and know the truth. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth that you have given us. That you have taken us, individuals who trust themselves, individuals who take advantage of our freedom, but you continue to call us back to the cross. May we live out our lives for you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
At this time, I invite you to rise.